The idea of traditional family is under furious assault in our Western world. So is education. Why are these foundational institutions of human happiness in danger of extinction? Discover the evil spirit being behind this disturbing trend. Next, on The Key of David with Gerald Flurry.
Greetings, everyone. Melanie Phillips is a journalist that writes for the London Times, which is one of the greatest newspapers in all the world. And she recently wrote a book titled Guardian Angel, My Story, My Britain. And in that, she talks about problems that are plaguing America and Britain. And she's been what she calls herself, as a culture warrior for over decades. And she has especially fought to strengthen the traditional family and also to improve the educational system. Now, she believes these twin pillars of our society are being plagued at this time and even attacked. Now, this book is not right or left, it's not political. She is talking about problems that she believes are real, and she follows the evidence wherever it leads her and tries to the best of her ability to tell us the truth. I think that America and Britain need to wake up and consider what she's talking about in this book. And it certainly has some really great ideas. And she says that what she's talking about is really an all-out war. But let me give you now a serious charge she has made. She believes her opponents are not only against traditional family, but that they are trying to destroy the traditional family. Now, could that be true? I mean, after all, if that's true, we all need to consider it, and it is like a diabolical plot, if that's true. But I'll tell you, it's more than just that. And I'll show you that in this program. The strength of any nation really is it's the strong families. And even the Chinese will tell you that, and many other nations. But listen to this. If you think this is not serious, and there isn't a real war going on, maybe you need to look at this and listen to what she has to say here. Notice what she says in this quote from her book. And when I started writing about family breakdown, I was also called, quote, an Old Testament fundamentalist. Now, if you know very much about the Bible, you know that 25% of the New Testament is actually quotes from the Old Testament. But here, the Old Testament is being discussed, and she's being called an Old Testament fundamentalist. She said, at the time, I shrugged this aside as merely a gratuitous bit of bigotry. Much later, however, I came to realize that it was actually a rather precise insult. My assailants had immediately understood something I did not myself at the time understand, that the destruction of the traditional family had as its real target the destruction of biblical morality. So this goes much deeper than what we would normally think, but she's talking about biblical morality that they're fighting against, these opponents. But they understood that the banner behind which I was actually marching was the biblical moral law. Now, she goes on to say that there, of course, that law puts certain restraints on us because it is, after all, a law that is the glue that holds things together. It's often an attack by the opponents, really, against the Old and the New Testament. It's against the Bible itself, and it's against the morality or the spirituality of the Bible. So what would cause somebody to want to attack the Bible and its morality or its spirituality. What would cause people to do that? Well, the Bible says it's our only hope. And the founding fathers of the American Constitution certainly used many biblical principles in that Constitution. So according to the Bible, you see, if you fight against that, I mean, that's like, that's like the ultimate sin. So we all need to look at this carefully. Here's another quote from Melanie Phillips. The belief that the Western nation was innately and oppressively judgmental gave rise to a parallel onslaught against the Judeo-Christian heritage. Well, we all know that our society grew out of that. This great march through the institutions captured virtually the entire British intellectual and governing establishment. It led to the undermining of education and the traditional family and behavioral constraints in favor of cultural and moral relativism and hyper-individualism. You have to say that what she's saying here is mind-staggering, and we have a booklet called America Under Attack, and you need to write for a copy of that because it explains this to you and explains what the Bible would call the depths of Satan. Are we getting into something like that? Well, Melanie Phillips says that the family is the issue of issues. It's the most important of all. And I'm going to add to that, the God family is the issue of issues in the entire Bible. And we are born into that family if we prepare ourselves. So this goes much deeper than what just, let's say, the traditional family. I'm adding this myself, but the gospel itself is the good news of the coming kingdom or family of God. And the true church is the family of God on this earth is actually the kingdom of God in embryo. If you can believe that. The physical family is a type of the God family. And it relates to the whole master plan of God. It's right at the heart of it. So there's a traditional family breakdown. And look, if you have a breakdown of that traditional family, you also have a breakdown of God's master plan. So this does reach into the Bible, the very heart and core of what the Bible's all about. The family is indeed the issue of issues. Let's notice Revelation 12 and verse 12. I'll show you how that Satan attacks the spiritual family or the church or spiritual Israel. Verse 12, therefore rejoice, you heavens, and you that dwell in them. Woe to the inhabitants of the earth and of the sea. For the devil has come down unto you having great wrath, because he knows he has but a short time. Now I believe I can prove to you that that event, him being cast down, happened in 1986. And let me tell you, he is behind the family breakdown, the traditional family breakdown. Now that's bad news, but it's a sign of good news because it says he's full of wrath because he knows he has but a short time. He knows his time is running out. The Messiah is about to come. Jesus Christ is about to return to this earth. Now, he says, woe to the inhabitants of the earth and of the sea even. How serious is this? Well, it's about to end. It has to. Only God can stop all of this turmoil and evil in this world. But Satan is the god of this world, 2 Corinthians 4 and verse 4. But I want to show you where Satan attacked first when he was cast to this earth for the second time. The first time was before man was even created, and I'll talk to you a little bit about that later. But notice verse 13. Here is his first attack. And when the dragon saw that he was cast into the earth, he persecuted the woman, a type of the true church here. It's always a type of a church, but here it's a true church, which brought forth the man child, Jesus Christ himself, as a baby, was brought forth in this church, this true church of God. Now, Satan was cast down, and the very first entity that he attacked was the true church, which is a type of the family of God and is spiritually the very family of God or kingdom of God in embryo right now. It is the kingdom of God or family of God in embryo. It's both the same. The kingdom of God is a family. And that family is going to administer the government of God and rule over the world. That rulership is the kingdom of God or the family of God. And today, God's people, His true church, is being prepared to get ready to help Christ rule over the people in the millennium and well beyond that for all eternity. Now, we have booklets on that subject. God is a family is a booklet. And we also have one on the God family vision. The true church is God's family on this earth. And it is the embryo of the kingdom or family of God. Can you fathom that? Can we believe that? John 1 and verse 18 says that Jesus Christ came to declare the Father. The Father is the head of the family, and Christ was the Son. Talks about Him being the Son of God. And they rejected the Son of God and crucified the Son of God. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son. Now that's the ultimate love. God wants all of us in His family, even those who never knew God and died. He's going to resurrect them and give them an opportunity to know the true God. Now that is a wonderful truth. So Satan's number one goal after he attacks the spiritual family is to tear down the traditional family, which is a type of the family of God that will live for all eternity. Could Satan be the real power behind all this? Could that be true? Well, I'll tell you, your Bible thunders yes to that. Yes, indeed. Let's talk a little bit about education. Melody Phillips, that was like her second pillar that she was very much concerned about. And those two pillars, family and traditional family and education, are the pillars. The two main pillars. Notice what she says here. In this book, I wrote that education standards had not only plummeted, but education itself had been redefined. It's been redefined. So, well, there's an attack on education. Did you know that the family has also been redefined? What does that all mean? What does it mean to you and your country? Melanie Phillips is concerned about her country. She says, it's my story, my Britain. And she wants to do everything she can to help. But notice, she goes on to say, the ideological dogmas behind the unraveling of education were also eroding family life and the moral codes that kept civilized society together, replacing those by the no blame, no shame, no pain society. And then respect for authority, both in and outside the classroom, had collapsed. That wrecks everything if you don't have any authority. Notice she says authority was being disastrously confused with authoritarianism or dictatorship or something like that. Just authority. But if you don't have government and you don't have authority, you don't have a nation. You don't have anything without government. You just have chaos. You have lawlessness. And that is what tears everything apart. Notice this. She says, most teachers I wrote were unaware that they were the unwitting troops of a cultural revolution, being now taught to teach according to doctrine whose core aim was to subvert the fundamental tenets of Western society. Wow. And notice this shocking statement. A generation of activists had captured academia. Now, you may agree with that, you may not, but this is a charge she makes, and I'm telling you, she is knowledgeable in this area like few people on this earth. And she says that a generation of activists had captured academia. So there is a war. And I mean, you could make a case for the fact that we're losing it. And what does that mean for you? What does it mean for all of us? Notice another quote here. For an editor to object to the sources upon whom a writer was drawing was positively chilling, she said. And that's what they were doing to her. And during this time, I badly needed some public support for the campaign against me in the education world had taken a particularly vicious turn. A vicious turn. What does that mean? Well, she said, we both happened to believe that the entire education establishment had taken a desperately wrong turn. How is that? And why did that happen? Let me just give you what she said about history and history teachers. History teachers who resist the very idea that they should teach British history as an elitist irrelevance. It's all irrelevant. To even teach British history, it's elitist and irrelevant. Now that gets to the core of destroying Western civilization. That's what this has to be about. Well, that's the worst news you could hear in many ways. Winston Churchill, who led Britain to victory in World War II, he saved Britain from Adolf Hitler, who led Germany at that time, and he was absolutely steeped in history. And that's what made him foresee what was coming on Britain and what was coming out of Germany, by knowing history. If you don't know anything about history, you can't see into the future. But history gives you insight into the future. That's what Churchill said. He learned the greatest lessons of all, and we have proof of that in our former prophet's booklet. There's a chapter on a law of history, and you really need to understand that. Notice what I wrote in America Under Attack, a booklet you really need to read. All of our literature is free. But Hitler said, what you tell people in the mass in a receptive state of fanatic devotion will remain words received under a hypnotic influence or radical and impervious to every reasonable explanation. Can that be true? Are people that easily hypnotized? Well, Hitler said they were. He continued, a new age of magic interpretation of the world is coming, of interpretation in terms of the will and not of the intelligence. That's really what, in a way, it is tied into all of this. That's what's happening to many people on this earth. And many of those opponents of that traditional family and a strong educational system, like we've had in many years past, but it's no longer that way in many cases. Notice what the Apostle Paul said. Let no man beguile you. This is Colossians 2, verses 18 and 23. Let no man beguile you of your reward in a voluntary humility and worshiping of demons, it should read, intruding into those things which he has seen, it should read, and that is the correct translation. Vainly puffed up by his fleshly mind, which things have indeed a show of wisdom in will worship. Will worship. It's all interpreted according to the will. They were worshiping their own will, which was, well, implanted there and led by the devil. That's what Paul said to these first century Christians, true Christians, inside God's own church, and they were fell victims to that. See, this goes to the depths of Satan, according to the Bible. If it's true, we'd better understand it and do something about it. This booklet goes on to say, intruding in verse 18 means to invade, to make a hostile incursion into. Thayer's lexicon. The Laodicean churches of the past and present were invaded by Satan. That means God's own churches were invaded by the devil. How did he get to them? How did he do that? Well, notice verse 8, beware lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit after the tradition of men, after the rudiments of the world, and not after Christ. Well, what do you know about that? What does that mean? Vain philosophy is after the rudiments of the world. What does that mean? Well, the New Testament, today's English version, translates that expression as ruling spirits of the universe, a demon attack through philosophy, through education. You think it won't happen? You think it can't happen? The Bible prophesies that it will happen and is happening. Those in education should beware, because Satan deceives the whole world. And you know how he does that? It says that in Revelation 12 and verse 9, you know how he does it? Through education. And there are always those, I have a quote here, and you can read it in the booklet yourself if you write for it or request it. This professor said, well, you have to have somebody to explain to you the theological and philosophical part of the Bible. But beware of such a person as that. If you look at Ezekiel 28 and verse 15, this is an Ezekiel booklet that we'll send you, and it's about the end time. It proves that to you time and time again. And notice what it says about Satan the devil. You were perfect in your ways from the day that you were created till iniquity was found in you. That means lawlessness. Iniquity should read lawlessness. That's what it's all about. By the multitude of your merchandise, they have filled the midst of you with violence. With violence. Well, how about that? The earth is being filled with violence now because Satan has been cast down in this end time. It was prophesied to happen. And Ezekiel goes on to talk about him being the covering cherub. He once covered the very throne of the majestic God. Verse 19, and God is going to take care of him. You shall be a terror, but never shalt you be any more. God is going to put a stop to him. Isaiah 14 is an end time book as well. You can read that in Isaiah 30 and verse 8, where it says that the time to come, it should read the latter day. Isaiah was written in a book for the latter day. So it's dual. It's dual. And then there, Isaiah 14 is about Satan being rebelling and trying to overthrow God. And he was cast back down to this earth. That was before man was created. Now in this end time, he's cast down again, and this time confined to the earth. He can't even go up to God's throne anymore and talk to God. But Satan and all those millions of demons are confined to this earth, and they're attacking America, and they're attacking Britain, and they're attacking the Jewish nation in the Middle East for a particular reason. How you have fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, God says of him. And it said, goes on to say that he has made the earth tremble. He has that kind of power to make the earth tremble and shake nations. But I'll tell you, if you look into this more, some of these demonstrations Melanie Phillips talks about that were not altruistic like you sometimes think they are, but they have a different purpose. And we need to know what that is. We need to understand the depth of what is going on in our nations, and make sure that we let God guide us, and those things, those evil things, won't happen to us individually. Until next week, this is Gerald Flurry. Goodbye, friends.
America has steeply declined morally, spiritually, culturally, socially, educationally, politically, economically, and militarily over the past 3 decades. You need to know why. Request America Under Attack, Ezekiel, the End Time Prophet, and Education with Vision.